Oh, this is very dark. Yeah. Okay, guys, I know it's the last talk of the day, so you're probably tired, and I can see the room, also not so many people, probably everybody's waiting for the after party. But I promise you, I'm going to make it fun today for you. So first of all, I'm going to quickly introduce myself. So this is my face, and easy, right? That's my name, Jamie Maria Schouren. You can forget about the last part because it's really difficult to pronounce. I'm a co-founder of the company called Deity. We're based in the Netherlands. And this is my Twitter handler. Please follow us so you can see what we're doing. So I have another small announcement, and actually I'm very happy to share with you that yesterday it was my birthday. So I was 29 yesterday. So I'm happy to share some drinks with you tonight and celebrate my birthday here in Odessa. Who knows this screen? Okay, tell me. Yes, indeed. It's the Back to the Future console. And what it says is that on the top, it was the destination time, April 23, 2018. Which means that at the moment, we should be in the future, right? Because they went to the future, which was about 1 year ago. And if I look at the movie, I can actually see that they were quite right about it. Because when I see what they predicted, they said we would have self-lacing shoes. And we actually got them. They also told us that we would have some kind of tablets that we can use as a computer, and of course we got them as well. They predicted in the movie that we would have a hovercraft kind of board, and they also predicted that there is some kind of device out there where you can do this with, but obviously the biggest trend of 2018 was this thing. And I think it comes pretty close to the hoverboard. Then they told us you will have glasses, which are computers. And we also got them. They predicted even that we would be able to do video chats and video calling. And of course, we all know this from Skype and all the other tools that we have them. But one thing I'm 100% sure that they predicted right, that today is the future, is that they also predicted who would be the supervillain. And the supervillain would be a blonde guy living in a tower. And I think they also predicted him very right. So basically, that means that the future is now, right? They said the future is now, it should be now. But is it really? Because if I look at the state of the web in 2018, 2019, this is what we have. Websites loading. Asking to send us stuff, asking to send us more stuff, asking us if we agree with privacy and if we're over 18, and it doesn't matter whatever I fill in, 1299, I'm still gonna be fine. Do I live here? Is this my city? Do I want to have a newsletter? When I'm finally there, some chat pops up, asking me if I'm having an ad blocker and did I find what I was looking for, and no, website is not loading, but maybe I want to share it on social media. And I'm very sad that this is the state of the web, because we have 5 billion devices connected to the internet today, and it's growing, this number is growing. And these are not just tablets and phones and laptops, these are also fridges and washing machines and all this kind of other stuff that we have around us that is connected. And if I look at how we use devices, this is a very interesting chart. So you see the green line going up, and you see a blue line going down. And the blue line is desktop, and the green line is mobile. And it's somewhere in 2017, it started to collide, and it's almost similar now. Which basically tells me that we're using both devices. They're equal. People have a phone and a desktop, and this is what we use. So we should focus a little bit more on that. And specifically, if I look at how we use devices, and this is some chart from Facebook, and it's saying, okay, we have 94% people are using mobile, but 62% of people are accessing the internet mobile only. So why are we still bothered about desktops? And if we have mobile only, we should really focus on that, but mobile websites tend to show us this. Load times. And especially if I look at some numbers, we can see that 53% of users are leaving websites after a 3 seconds load time. And if you're doing e-commerce, then you will know that 1 second delay with a shop that at 100K turnover a day is losing 2.5 million euro. 1 second a day. 1 second load time, 2.5 million in a year. So we're talking about 3 seconds, 4 seconds, 5 seconds, but does anybody know what is the average loading time of a mobile device on a 3G network? Can you take a guess? Shout a number, how many seconds?
10 seconds.
10 seconds, you think 10, who thinks more? Who thinks less? No hands, what do you think? 10 is right, one hand. Well, actually, it's gonna be very surprising to you that the average loading time is 19. And a 4G network is not much better, it's 14. This is the web. So, we are developers and obviously we know how to do stuff, so we said we can fix this, right? We're gonna fix this and we're gonna do that. And we did that in 2009 with something called HTML5. And you probably all remember, and there were some big companies like this guy who said, let's do this. Let's go to the HTML5. So what did they do? In 2012, they released the Facebook Hybrid app. And did anybody of you use this? I think probably some people will, because actually it was the most downloaded app ever. And the funny thing is, it was also the baddest one. It had 1.4 million reviews, or more than 1 million reviews on 1.4 rating. And then the guy said, well, the biggest mistake we made as a company was betting too much on HTML5 as opposed to native. So this is also the time that we all said, you know, let's go to native. Let's go to native 2012, let's build native apps. And it had a lot of advantages, I mean, it still has. It has advantages in performance, it has advantages in smooth animations and interactions, instant loading, and you can even show some stuff offline. You have easy access through the home screen and a super high engagement. And if we look at the numbers on how we use our phones, we also see that 87% of our time we're actually spending in these native apps. So why is this talk about progressive web apps? People are using native apps so much. Well, that is because apps are very highly concentrated. And actually, app usage is just 80% of our time we spend on 3 apps. And that's mainly social media app, Facebook or something, and you're using some messenger app and maybe some news app. These are the top 3 apps that people are using. And do you know what is the average amount of apps that are being downloaded per user per month? Can anybody guess a number? 2? You think 2? Somebody thinks more? 50? Average? 5. 1. Well, you're going to be very surprised, because it's 0. Oh, wait, 1 back. Actually, 0, yeah. So why don't we download apps? Well, that's because apps have a lot of disadvantages. And one of the disadvantages is the distribution problems. Because, yeah, you have to guide people through the app. You cannot really distribute it very easily. Updating is a pain, you know, because people also have to update you. Application size and memory usage is very difficult. You have different operating systems. If I have a website and native apps, I'm building 3 systems. I'm building a responsive website, I'm building an iOS app, and I'm building an Android app. 3 systems to maintain and 3 systems to build. And there is a 10% revenue to the App Store. And actually, the iOS App Store has a 30% Apple tax. 30% of your revenue is going to Apple. And we don't really want that. Like, we work hard for our money, we want to get the money that we earn. So this is where I call it the search for happiness started. Because we wanted to have the experience of an app, but we didn't want to have the disadvantages of the app. And with happiness, I mean it's the same experience in the web browser, but then really mimicking what's happening in native apps on a smartphone. And this search for happiness started with all kind of these initiatives. And maybe some of you use this kind of stuff. There is Chrome Apps, Crosswalk Project, there is some BlackBerry even jumped in. But they all kind of failed. And most of them failed because they're not linkable. You cannot link to them. Which, in my opinion, if you cannot link to your content, then you're not, are you really part of the internet then? If you cannot guide people organically to your content. So finally, in 2016, the web strikes back, right? So we finally have a solution for this. And there was a company called Google, and they came up with this concept called AMP. Do you know about AMP? Yeah, it's called accelerated mobile pages. So what do accelerated mobile pages do? They can very fast load pages. And the Weather Channel used this, and they had on the 1 second page load 10 times less data, instant access to information, and a 4 times higher click-through rate. But the problem is here, they're not dynamic. These pages are static, these are landing pages, and you cannot really do anything with it in e-commerce or when you, you know, want to show some personalization or very dynamic data. So then Google went back to the drawing table and they got very creative because they said, let's turn this around and make AMP into PWA. So what is the main difference between these two things? Well, actually, we have AMP, fast landing pages, and then we have PWA, which is happiness. Because PWA actually merges the best of two worlds. So we have, I'm not sure if people in the back can read this, but you have native apps who can do certain things and who cannot do certain things. And there is responsive websites who can do certain things and cannot do other things. And then progressive web app can do all. So we're talking about functioning offline, sending push notifications, installable on home screen, full screen experience. It can be indexed by search engines. There's one place to enter your content and one place to maintain. It works across all the devices. You don't need to do a download, and it doesn't require updates because we update from the server, so the user doesn't have to do an update. So what is a progressive web app then? Well, you can break it down in three things. A progressive web app is fast, it's reliable, and it's engaging. And what do we mean with that? When we look at speed, fast, here is a project of the Washington Post, and on the left side you're going to see the instant mobile web, instant speed, and on the right side is the current mobile web. And this company is, I think, spending quite a lot of money in doing this kind of stuff, so they're pretty good. So I'm going to play it, and you're going to see, watch it, don't blink, it's very fast. Left side is done. And the right side is done now. 3.3 seconds is a fast website versus 0.9. And what is the main difference between these two? On the right side, it's just a very fast website. And if I click through to another page, the page is going to have to load again. You're going to get the similar loading time. On the left side, everything is now on my device. Everything is there. So as soon as I click again, or I go offline, or lose connection, or whatever is happening, the page is loading even faster than before, because everything is already there. And that is what we talk about when we talk about instant speed and basically caching. So Tinder also did this. You probably know this company, and they turned the thing into a progressive web app, and they have now 7.2 seconds faster, 90% smaller, more messages, more swipes, and longer sessions, just by improving to a progressive web app. So, next thing I want to show you is about engagement. So what actually is engagement? And one of the most things we know about engagement is push notifications, right? So when we talk about you can do push notifications from websites, there's e-commerce companies coming up and saying, oh, this is so cool, you know, you can start sending all kind of advertisement. But obviously, nobody's going to press the button next here. Nobody's going to do that. Everybody's going to press the cross because we have enough advertisement. But using progressive web app technology, you can actually have access to information on the device. So, for example, you can have things like location, and you can know where someone went before, this kind of stuff. So you can send very, very engaging messages to someone which do work. For example, this. It says in the text, get your groove on, 25% off cocktails all weekend at the Fizzle nightclub. Because I know I've been there. I know you're still in the neighborhood, and I know I love cats. And these kind of things have a very high click-through rate. They have about, if you compare it to email, email has about 2%, 3% click-through rates. These go up to 10, 20% click-through rates if you do it right. I mean, this is the kind of engagement that we want, right? So Lancome, a company, did it. They have 53% increase in mobile sessions on iOS, 8% purchases coming from push notifications, and with that, they're able to 12% recover the cart. By just sending a push notification, there is stuff still in your cart. And the very interesting about this case is that actually, push notifications are not allowed on iOS devices. So the push notifications are only being sent to Android devices. And then if you look at the data and the users going to this website, 62% of them are iOS users. So they're able, just by a very small part of the audience, they're still able to get 8% more purchases there. Very high revenue growth there. So, talking about offline and online, who remembers this device? This device. Oh, it's very white now. Can you see it actually? No, it's very, the thing is a little bit off. Well, it's a fax modem, 56K fax modem. Does anybody remember what it was? Yeah, tell us. Yeah, it was for the internet. And do you remember the noise it made?
Yeah.
Yeah? Because this thing was taking us online. And you knew if you were online. Because first of all, you could hear it. The thing was making a very specific noise. But also, nobody could pick up the phone. Because if somebody would pick up the phone, your internet was dead. So going online back then was really an experience. You know, you were going online. And that's something we don't know today anymore. We expect to be online all the time. So we don't go online anymore, we're always online. And Progressive Web Apps can actually help with that. Because Progressive Web Apps make sure that even if you have a bad connection, even if your internet is falling down all the time, you can still serve the content to your users. Uber did this. And Uber are able to load within 3 seconds on 2G. And they were not able to do that before without a Progressive Web App. So that means that they fully opened a new market. Because they finally can serve their product to a market which has 2G. And there's quite a lot of that in the world. So for them, this was a huge business opportunity to do this. So back, but what actually is a Progressive Web App? So a Progressive Web App is, according to our friends from Google, they say it's a whole lot of things. So Progressive Web App is progressive, it's responsive, it's connectivity independent, it's app-like, it's fresh, it's safe, it's discoverable, re-engageable, installable, and linkable. Yeah, but what is it? So technically speaking, a Progressive Web App from the tech side are basically three things. It's a website served over HTTPS. There is a service worker, and there's a web app manifest. That's it. And I don't really have to explain you about what HTTPS is, I think, so I'm going to skip that part, but I'm going to explain you the rest. So a web app manifest, first of all, and probably you cannot see this code there, a web app manifest is basically just a text file, a JSON file, with some metadata in there. It's telling us what is the theme color, what is the icon, the background color, and the name for my Progressive Web App. And this file makes sure that I can be added to a home screen. Because I'm telling the device and I'm telling the browser, so what is in this home screen? You know, what should I show and what should I look like if someone opens me from the home screen? If I'm installed, what is the icon? When I open it, what is the splash screen? That's it. One JSON file and you're installable on a home screen. So it actually looks like this. So here is a website, and here this is an Android device, and then it recognizes that it has this file, a web app manifest, and then it's asking me, hey, do you want to add this to your home screen? I click, done. No app store in between, and I'm installed on the home screen immediately. Very, very easy path to guide your people to use your device. iOS also does it. It has one step in between. You can try it, and there you have to click the button and physically add it to the home screen, and it's there. Pop again. No interference of any app store here, and still, it really acts like an app. So when I open it, it's not a browser shortcut. So you can try it with some websites, and you will see the difference, because you're going to find some websites who still just have the browser shortcut, and you're going to find some websites who actually open like an app. So Flipkart did this, and when they did it, they had 70% more conversion. 70%. That's a big number. 3 times less data usage. So it's also a big number for them, right? Trivago did it as well. 150% growth of engagement from the add-to-home screen users, and they almost doubled their conversion rates. These are big numbers, just by adding this file. So there's another thing to Progressive Web Apps, it's called service workers. And does anybody know about service workers? Are there people who know about service workers here? Some people? Good. Some more people? Okay, I'm going to explain you a little bit, walk through very quickly what it is. Basically, a service worker is a client-side JavaScript proxy. I mean, that's quite a handful. And what it does is you can use it to improve performance, make your app offline first. It's the base for very advanced features like push notifications and stuff. So it basically works like this. So I have my device on the left. there is a service worker in between me and the web server. So the first time I hit, the service worker will get installed. And then the second time I come, when I go to another page, the service worker is saying, hey, is there something new? Yes, then I'm going to send you to the server. If there's something not new and the website is still the same, I'm going to show you the cache. So this also means you can go offline. Because if the web server is not connecting with your device, you can still get all the stuff that you need, what the things actually we as developers have put in that cache. And I can deliver super high performance here. So how does it basically work? Service workers have a life cycle, and they have a registration, they have an installation, and an activation. So when there is no service worker, the thing is getting installed and it's getting activated, and then you know there's this thing happening. So every single time I go back and there is a one byte difference, it's going to reinstall, and if not, it's just going to keep the way it was before. So how does this work? So the registration, and I think it's really hard to see from the back these codes, but basically here it says, hey, is there a service worker? Is it already installed? Yes or no? Is there a difference? Yes or no? Then I'm going to install it. And it's really fast. You don't see it. As a user, you don't feel any delay there. There's nothing happening there. Here's the installation. So it says it calls the event, OK, perform the task, and give me the thing. And actually, the funny thing is you can, during the installation and during this activation part here, you can already do everything. So you can send all this stuff. The whole cache is there now. So it's actually super fast, immediately in there. So what if you want to use this to do send push notifications? Well, basically, it works like this. So you have your server. Then you have a web push protocol request. It's talking to a push service, and that one is talking to the service worker on the device. And basically what you do, you call two APIs, the notification API and the push API. And why are there two? That's mainly because the push API makes sure that the messages arrives on your device if your browser is closed. Even closed in the background, you can still get the messages there. So also when I send out a message, now a push notification, and someone you know has a whole phone off and they turn it on again, they can still arrive there because it's waiting with the service worker to come. So what I first do when I want to do this, I need to ask for permission, obviously, because we cannot start spamming everyone. That would be very fun, but also not fun. So I ask for permission, and it's checking if I already gave permission. And the funny thing is, you only have to ask permission once. So the browser just has to ask permission once, and it's just one press of a button, yes or no. So when I do that, the permission is granted, and the device gets registered. So the push, the device gets registered with the service worker. And this service worker is registering with our push API. So that also means that I don't know what this device is. So it's super safe. There is very GDPR proof, because I don't know the name of this device. I just get like a code there. It looks something like this. When I start then sending a push notification, I have my body, I can send an icon, and you can even send things like vibrating patterns. So you can even make your push notification very special and give it a special vibration. 100 milliseconds off, 50 on, and 100 off. You can do some crazy stuff there to really make people aware that it's you. And then obviously there is a data and there's a primary key there because I need to know if someone opened it or not without knowing the actual device and without knowing if someone is who that is. And obviously there is my stuff saying, hey, what do I want to show there? Hello world. So it will look something like this on the browser. Obviously on the phone it will look exactly as a push notification on the phone. And what you see here is that I can add buttons there. And the funny thing is, I can actually add buttons which are different from the actual push notification location. So for example, I have a shop selling cars. And someone has been looking at the cars all the time, and then I have this car again, and I'm sending them, hey, here is the car again. But the car is black. And I can add a button saying, do you prefer a red car? Click here. So I can really get a very nice interaction with my customers there. So here are the actions. Obviously, there goes the action. So I have the explore, you go to the site, or I have no thank you, then I have no thank you. So I know what is happening on that site. So I get something back, like for example, notification close or click, obviously. And I can do stuff with that data because I can calculate what was the click-through rate here. The only tricky part about this is you have to actually close the notification. So if someone does a bulk close of notifications, then it doesn't register as closed. So someone actually has to close that specific notification for me to register it. So the clicking, yeah, it's very simple. It goes like this. There is an event. Hey, this event, you know, is this action close? It's closed. Thank you. And close the window. Or go to the specific page that I recommended to go. So how does it work on the other side? So we're sending and receiving these push notifications. Well, it looks like this. So I have my server, and I'm sending it to the push subscription endpoint and server, which is in the browser. And that one is connecting to the device there. So if I just look at this push subscription endpoint, it's telling me, hey, you know, here is this, I have to check, is there registration, yes or not? Because I'm sending this to everyone. Very different from email marketing, where you send to a specific list. I'm actually sending this to everyone. And then the service worker is saying, am I registered? Or do I have these kind of things that you send me, like I only want to send to people in Amsterdam? Do I, yes or no? So the service worker is dividing if I'm in that group or not. So here is then, you send it to the endpoint, and this endpoint is from a Google browser, from Chrome, and obviously there's the keys there, so I know it's safe. So here goes my server, and on my server, this is what I write. So this is in Node, and I write basically, here is the push notification, here is the API key where it's going to, and there is a time to deliver. Because obviously, you don't want to send a push notification with a flash sale and then have people arriving at like 3 days later, because that doesn't make sense. So you can set a time to deliver there. So here, and there is some icons there, but they're very white out, so I'm not sure why you cannot see them. So there's only the black one there, because that is the service worker that's saying yes or no, allow me to the device. So basically it looks like this in a very schematic overview. In the browser, the push arrives, the service worker starts, it handles the message or not, and then it shows the notification. And when it shows the notification, you can get stuff like this. And we can be all very happy that this is appearing on our phones. So, if I break it down again, we have three things to add, right, to be a progressive web app. We have a service worker, we have to be HTTPS, and we have to be a web app manifest. That means that literally any website can be a progressive web app, right? Just add these things. Well, that's not really true, because progressive web apps are about the web being done right. It's really about user experience. It's about engagement, and it's about giving the same experience as we have with native apps from the web. And with doing right, I mean projects like this. Webshop.nl, it's a Dutch web shop. It's a very easy name to remember. We built this. It has 7 million products on live, 19 million tested, and it was built in just 2 months. And it has an instant search there. And I'm going to show you what I mean with instant. You can see this video. I'm typing here Lego. And as you can see, it's searching in 8 million products on this version. Lego Green. Can click. It's showing some things where I can actually buy. This kind of a price comparison website. And then I can even go back and I type here dress and whatever. But the funny thing is, if you see them appearing, the images, there is like a small delay because you see a little bit of white and then you see the images. And we actually built that. Because the images were appearing, the products were appearing immediately, and people didn't see that something was changing. And you can see it and you can test it easily, because in the top, as when I'm typing, in the top, and you cannot see it here, but try it, every single time I hit a key, it's appearing in the URL. And the images are actually appearing a little bit later, because we deliberately made it a little bit less fast. Because people are not really used to that. So PWA is not just about being the fastest thing out there, it's really about giving the right experience to your customers. So another one we did is called The Rake. It's a magazine in the UK, and it had 80% growth in organic traffic. Instant loading, but it has something else. It has a headless architecture. So it's more than just a PWA. And what I mean with that is that this magazine, so you can see it's quite fancy. So they came to us and they said, we want to have a content-driven web shop. And we want to use Magento, and we want to use WordPress at the exact same time. Can you please merge these two? And we were like, yeah, we can, but we won't. Because if I do it, it's going to be fine, and you can work with it, but you can never change anything. It's going to be a hell of a job to maintain, and it's going to be a hell of a job to change something. Because if you want to replace WordPress at some time or want to add some module in there, you're going to have a problem. So what we did, we made it headless. So we turned it into a headless web shop by having the front end, then an API layer there, and there is the back end. The front end is built in React, then the API layer, basically the service layer, has been built with Node.js and GraphQL in there now, and there's the back end. But the backend is not just one backend, because the backends are more things. So the backend can be Magento. It can be Algolia at the same time. There is WordPress in there. There is PayPal, and there's Akinio in there. And all these things are working separately. They're not integrated with each other. So the frontend knows where do I need to get this data and to pull it up. That also makes it easy not only to maintain and to extend, but it also makes it very easy if you want to switch something out. So if at some point they say, hey, we want to get rid of WordPress, we don't like it anymore, I want to have Type3 in there, we can actually do this. If it was tightly coupled, we had no way of doing that. I mean, we could, but it would take, you know, rebuilding a whole new project there. But actually, in this way, you can very easily do it because you just switch out the API. So what are the results of this kind of stuff when you build this? Well, it's this. 100, 100, 100, 100 Lighthouse cores. And why is it so fast? It's so fast because we're using a React.js framework on the front. Then we have a Node.js server taking really care of things like caching and such. And it's a single page application. And the last one is a very tricky one because you can build very nice single page applications, but Google will not see you. So you need to make sure that you're using things like server-side rendering there or else you're going to have a problem and you're still not linkable. So after launching this project, we had many people who were like, well, what did you do and how did you do it? Can we use it? So we decided to open source it. And the project is called Data Falcon. And basically what Data Falcon is, it's a developer toolkit to create progressive web apps. It's platform agnostic, it's extensible, and you can build any type of website. So not just e-commerce, but you can do blogs, you can do whatever you want to do with it. There's a GitHub link, and please visit, give some stars and stuff, so we can move forward. Pictures done? Yes? Good. I have some flyers here as well with the information on, so please take some. So to show you how this looks like behind the scenes, here is the drawing of the architecture, and yeah, you probably cannot read this in the back specifically, but on the top, it's basically two products, because on the top there is a Falcon client, and this is the UI layer, and this is built in React, but it can be anything you want to use. You can add Gatsby, or you can use Vue.js, it doesn't matter. And then the magic happens in the Falcon server. So this is where we use, for example, Apollo, there's proxy that we do caching there, and we have an extension layer. And this extension layer is saying, hey, is this a block, is this dynamic, is this a shop? So you can use all these different tools at the same time. Then underneath, you can start adding APIs from whatever service you want to use. So we have GraphQL in there, so you can use Magento and connect it to Magento, or BigCommerce, or WordPress, or Golia, or Elastic. You can use whatever you want to use there. So this is the main architecture, and we specifically build this to be able to give people the option to really make it extensible. So we didn't want to build a very fast team. We really want to build a toolkit so you can actually do stuff yourself and build it and use it for any project you wanted to use. And actually, I think we're on the good way, but we still have some way to go. Because according to Gartner, by 2020, 50% of the web needs to be replaced, of general apps need to be replaced by progressive web apps. 50% in 1 year, we have 1 year to go. And I think we're way behind. So we made it even easier for you to start. And we launched this thing, so within three steps in NPM, with this three code lines, you can actually start. So when you do this, on your screen will pop up the basic Falcon. There will be a Magento server and a WordPress server, so you can start playing around, switching out, and do whatever you want to do with it. So please give it a try, 5 minutes, you have it up and running, and you're going to have a store with 100, 100, 100, 100 Lighthouse scores there. So before I end this presentation, and we can all move on to have some drinks, there's one last thing I want to share with you. And that is the fact that progressive web apps are not new. It's not something Google invented. It's not something we just came up with. Because actually, in 2007, Steve Jobs presented the very first iPhone. And what he says, this is an innovative new way to create applications for mobile devices. And he gave us a list. And he said, it's Web 2.0, it integrates with iPhone services, it has instant distribution, it's easy to update, it's secure, and it's sandboxed. And this is the definition of a progressive web app. This is it. But why didn't it go through in 2007? Does anybody know why it never happened and why we're doing it now? And also why Apple is actually now trying to hold back and not allowing all the features. Does anybody know? Correct. 1 year later, they launched the App Store. And this is where they make the famous 30% Apple tax. Thank you everyone for my presentation, and I have some stickers, I have some flyers, so please ask any question you want. No questions? Oh yeah, we have to do questions later, right?
Yeah. But I don't know. I will. I think we can ask a few questions. If because we are waiting for our sponsors.
There are questions? Yeah, good.
Thank you very much. Ultimately, could you please refine, does web app have future to replace native? Or
can you move the microphone a little bit closer? Sorry.
Does web apps has a future to replace native apps?
If I think that progressive web apps are going to replace native apps? Yeah, I think so. I really think so. I think for this is the new responsive, this is the new web standard. Eventually, they're going to replace them all. Because why would you still build several systems while you can use one? Why would you get through all this process with App Store and updating and all this stuff if you don't need to anymore? I mean, there might be some very specific use cases, like, for example, games or something, you know, you really want to play. But I still think in the future, when this technology is even more evolved, and, you know, that's why it's called progressive, because we can, you know, add things in the time. I think that eventually there's no need anymore to really have native stuff there. I'm not sure if I understand the question. Can you? There's a little bit noisy here with the door open, sorry.
In this case, how we can describe development of such platforms like Flutter and React Native? They provide a cross-platform experience. And in the same way, according to your words, as I understood, we have a sort of player like a web apps, progressive web apps, right?
Yeah.
In future, it will be on the same level of on a competition, because now I don't think so. It has same level of developing native-like application.
Well, it's depending on a use case. It depends, you know, what do you want to build and what is the use case for that. And you know, you can use, for example, our technology, but our technology is not the only one, you know, you can use to build this kind of standards, right? So you can use the technology that fits your application. And if at this moment you really need a native app for whatever reason, you know, you're going to have to use that at the moment. But I do think in the future, I mean, a few years ago, we were doing separate mobile webs and separate desktop websites, right? We were doing both. And there were many people then saying, yeah, why should we go to responsive? It's just complicated, and then you need to figure out what is the screen size before I can send some stuff, and that kind of stuff. And there were still companies really trying to get to, you need to add mobile dot and then my website to get the right thing there. But this eventually also evolved, and this technology evolved, and we got different screen sizes, so we couldn't build like five things because tablets came, and then we had to build specific for mobile, specific for tablets, specific for that. And you know, this is just a natural progression into where the web is moving to make it easier, to make it simpler, and to merge these technologies.
Thank you. I think that's all, because second stage will finish too.
Okay.
So thank you so much, Jamie Maria.